Blackstone Audio presents Armor by John Steakley. To my beloved father, first and foremost, John William Steakley, and to Eagle, first and foremost, Pal, this book is gratefully dedicated. Every single day, I love them both. You are what you do when it counts. The Maseo. Part 1. Felix. He drank alone, which was odd, since he didn't have trouble with people. He had always managed to make acquaintances without much effort, and despite what had happened, he still liked people. Recently, he had even grown to miss them again. Yet here he was, drinking alone. Maybe I'm just shy, he thought to himself, and then laughed at such a feeble attempt at self-delusion, for he knew what it was. From his place at the end of the long bar, he examined the others in the crowded lounge. He recognized a handful from training. Training was where it had begun, where he had felt that odd sensation descending upon him like mist, separating him from all those thousands of others around him in the mess hall. It was a dull kind of temporal shock at first, a reaction reverberating from somewhere deep within him. He had somehow known that they all would die. He shook his head, drained his glass. If he was in the mood for honesty, he would have to admit that his chances were no better at all. He paid the credits for a full bottle and then paid the extra credits to take it out of the lounge. It was strictly against orders on a battlecruiser to have a bottle in one's personal possession, but on the night before a drop, a lot of things were possible. And as the hour for the drop grew near, he noticed that his fellows were beginning to take their drinking more seriously. Outside the lounge wasn't much better. Lots of bottles had been smuggled out tonight. The ship wasn't exactly a giant party, but there were enough get-togethers here and there, and enough legitimate crew business here and there, to make it almost impossible to find a quiet place to sit and think. After a while, he had settled into an idle rhythm of walking, sipping, smoking, and hunting. After most of an hour of wandering about the corridors of the immense ship, he found himself standing beside the center template strut of Drop Bay 1. Drop Bay 1 was the largest single room in the ship, and since the Terra was the largest warship, the largest single room in space, it was over 100 meters long and 60 wide. Around him, in a checkerboard style, were the little square spaces for drop assignment. From here it all began. Thousands of men and women would go into battle from this room, at the same moment, if necessary. The overhead was 10 stories above him, crisscrossed with the immense cranes that lowered the equipment of war into position. A hell of a big room, he thought. Bigger even than the Hall of Gold back home, where he had first stood at age 10 beside the boys and girls of the other nobles and watched the coronation. He and the other children had had a tendency to giggle, he remembered, and so had been placed at the far end of the hall, away from the throne. Enough of this, he said to himself. That's over for me now. It's far, far away. He sighed, shook his head. He perched himself atop the center strut and lay down on his back and stared up at the distant overhead and didn't see it. Enough sentiment, he said aloud. It's time for brain work. Time, in fact, for a cold, logical assessment of the situation. He took a sip from the bottle, lit a smoke, and laughed again. Fact is, we haven't got a prayer. Fact was, most everybody in fleet nowadays was a rookie, over 60% and rising. That meant 6 months of advanced training, 9 months tops in the military altogether. Not much hope there. Still, the equipment was marvelous, and many were surprisingly good with it. He remembered his astonishment at discovering clearly apparent aptitude for, of all things, the battle armor. Most found the power suits almost impossibly alien in practice, and couldn't bring themselves to react in a sufficiently normal fashion, but he and a few others had taken to them easily, readily utilizing their potential as the long-sought key to a machine as extension of man's own puny form. How odd, he thought, that he should have such bizarre talents. He, of all people, had fit with Fleet's hopes. And from there his drunken thoughts slipped into the past, like most drunken thoughts of terrified humans. He lay back on the template and blew smoke at the distant cranes. He sipped steadily from the bottle. he feared. The hours passed. Lovers, in niches surrounding the perimeter of the bay, took advantage of the sexually integrated warrior class. They rocked and moaned and grasped one another. It was a united, if unorganized, effort by each and all to push the tension-taut present far ahead into the horrors of the future. After a while, they would rest from their labors, draining the last of the bottles and lighting the last.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.